microphone work? Does it work?
Yes.
We're not going to start singing yet. I got to introduce myself. I'm Bob Roberts. Some of you know me. I've preached here before. I'm a retired pastor, a member of Zion Bay City, and I live on Salzburg Road, so it's Salzburg, Salzburg, Salzburg. twice a month, I do a little service at Bayshore Nursing Home, and I'm going to do one this afternoon. And my pastor, Sherry, asked me, do you have a hymn? I said, oh, do I have a hymn? I have a whole service. Would you like to see the service? You can use any part of it. Well, he used the whole service. And he added some, being Pastor Sherry. But he forgot something, being Pastor Sherry. He added a sermon, which I don't preach at the issue. I talk through the whole service that we're doing. But, okay. He forgot the offering. Now, we could not take up an offering, but I don't think he would be very happy about that. So what we're going to do is we're going to take up the offering during the canticle, okay, right at the middle, right after the greeting. Because what they said about Jerry Ford, remember? He can't walk and shoot gun at the same time. Is not true about all Michiganders. You can give your offering and sing a hymn at the same time. We'll try to do that. The people at Bayshore don't have hymnals, so I print everything out. And because we want the service without a sermon to be about 40 minutes or a little bit less, I cut some of the verses. So if you pick up your hymnal and look in the hymnal and want to sing the music out of the hymnal, that's great. But beware, we're singing the verses that are printed. Sherry said, oh, do something for Bible class. Well, last fall we showed slides about what we've done in Africa this past summer. So this time we're just going to do a little show and tell of what we expect to be able to do. So Eileen's got a huge bag in the trunk. So if you want to see what all that stuff is in that huge bag, piece by piece, and talk about what we hope to do in Africa, come on over. If you've got other stuff to do, I don't feel bad. What else am I supposed to say? Christ is risen!
Christ is risen indeed.
Oh, come on. It's still Easter. You know the words. Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Yeah, that's better. Yeah. Let's begin. Thank you. Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Like newborn babes, long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation, if indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples, sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works, glory in his holy name, let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice, seek the Lord in his strength, seek his presence continually, remember the wondrous works that he has done. His miracles and judgments on earth. He remembers his covenant forever, the word that he commanded for 1,000 generations. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
Like newborn babes long for the pure spiritual milk, that by it you may grow up to salvation. If indeed you have tasted that the Lord is good. Be seated and sing the hymn first.
More precious than gold that perishes though it is tested by fire,
may be found to result in praise and glory and honor at the revelation of Jesus Christ. Though you have not seen him, you love him. Though you do not now see him, you believe in him and rejoice with joy that is inexpressible and filled with glory, obtaining the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We sing the first half of verses 1 to 4. Thomas answered him, "My Lord and my God." Jesus said to him, "Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have believed." Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of the disciples, which are not written in this book. But these are written so that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that by believing, you may have life in his name. This is the gospel of the Lord. Please be seated. We sing the next hymn. With fresh wonder and joy,
then we've caught the spirit of Easter. Christ is arisen, we say. Not just Jesus Christ rose from the dead, or even Christ has risen. Both of those very true statements place the resurrection back there somewhere, 2,000 years ago. Christ is arisen. Puts it where it belongs. It's not so much an action sentence as the description of the present state. The lights are on. Not just somebody turned them on an hour ago. Something that happened 2,000 years ago is just that. It's something that happened 2,000 years ago. I don't know. I don't care what Peter had for breakfast that first Easter Sunday. Maybe he had nothing. I neither know nor care what Caesar had for breakfast either. That was then. This is now. I am not greatly concerned about exactly where outside the city gates the cross stood or the tomb. I don't want to clutter my mind with the names of the soldiers or on duty that weekend conducting the executions or guarding the tomb. That was then. This is now, and it affects my life neither in time nor in eternity. I am concerned with one fact. Christ is risen. He lives. He lives for me now. And I too shall live with him forever. Thomas didn't doubt the fact of the empty tomb. The news, but not the scandal, was all around Jerusalem. Whispered from one corner to another. He didn't doubt that the women thought that they had seen angels, that the disciples believed that they had seen Jesus. So what? They were still hiding out in that room in Jerusalem. Jesus had told them to go back to Galilee. Even the women had remembered that. They had included it in their visions. Angels, spirits, ghosts. Ghost stories are a dime a dozen. Don't you people realize, says Peter, says Thomas, don't you people realize this is serious business? Jesus has been arrested, tried in a kangaroo court, handed over to the Romans, executed in the most shameful possible way, hanging on a cross. And now his body is gone. Ghost stories are for telling over campfires. When you're relaxing from work. When you're tired after a journey. Well, Thomas says, I'm tired too. Maybe I'll see the ghost. So, that's just me being tired. Unless I put my hand in the wounds, feel the prints of the nails and the lash, I will not believe. Other people's visions are just that, other people's visions. Maybe they get some comfort from them. If so, then God be praised. But, it's still Thomas speaking, remember. But I am not interested in empty tombs or visions of angels. I am interested in working for the appearance of the kingdom of God. I am interested in returning to Galilee. But you guys see, don't see what I want to do, even though Jesus said do it. Just like we did. Just like Jesus did when John the Baptist was arrested. With starting over again. One of these days we'll do it right. And then, in the upper room, Jesus appeared. I don't think Thomas ever touched those nail prints. Doesn't say he did. He just worshiped. My Lord and my God. And the words that Jesus gave the ten became real for Thomas. Peace be with you. Receive the Holy Spirit. Whose sins you forgive, they will stand forgiven. Whose sins you retain, they will stand retained. Christ is risen. Without these words, without faith in this fact, fact not just for yesterday, fact for today, fact for eternity, without faith in this fact, nothing else ever matters. We might as well just go home. Start over. Catch the vision of God's kingdom. Preach. Preach repentance without power. One day it'll work. One day that lost cause will catch fire. It's a noble thought. Without the resurrection, without the Spirit of God, it's the best that the best of human beings can aspire to. Thomas was no faithless fool, any more than our modern deniers of the resurrection are. They're not evil men. They're among the noblest of human beings. They're just with Thomas wrong. Without the resurrection, there is still truth and justice and forgiveness on the human plane. Without the resurrection, there's still human decency. But Christ is risen. He appeared to Thomas. And if we have not seen, nevertheless, he's been at work in our lives. He is here, as he promised. He is here. Whenever we gather in his name, he promised. He's here in a special way when we baptize in his name. Pastor Sherry's in Kansas. His grandson's being baptized. He's here in another special way when we celebrate the Holy Supper. Christ is risen, and with his peace and his Spirit, we can fall on our knees like Thomas and say, my Lord and my God. And with his peace and his Spirit, we can be his witnesses. Like Peter and Paul and John and Thomas. Speaking the words of his victory, Christ's victory for us. Not beginning again, but continuing his ministry with his authority, proclaiming the good news of forgiveness with power and authority from God, forgiving sins. That's what Pastor Sherry says. I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. He does that because Jesus said, do it. He doesn't just say, may your sins be forgiven. He doesn't just say, Jesus died. Jesus died for you. He says with the authority of Jesus, with the authority of the risen Christ, I forgive you all your sins. And that little baby, grandson of his, be baptized into the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, as you were. If Christ is arisen, then we too shall rise. Christ rose that April day, almost 1,000 years ago. The Father accepted his sacrifice. Death could not hold the Son of God. Christ has risen, and his death and resurrection neither can nor may be repeated. Death no longer has dominion over it. South America, where in Texas, Indiana, it's to the ones in English speak, beginning there. Can we try it again? Christ is risen.
He is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Let's stand.
The resurrection of the body.
that Jesus is Lord. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, confirm this victory that overcomes the world for our brothers and sisters who suffer disgrace and death for your name. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, pursue those who have wandered from the faith, that they may return to abide in you, the author of life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, foil any unrighteous plans of nations and leaders, and guide them down paths of justice and peace. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, guide the deliberations and judgments of our local government, that they may serve the livelihood of all in our community. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, lead us to the pure spiritual milk, that by its nourishment all the baptized may grow up to eternal life. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, hear the cries of the sick, the burdened, and the suffering, that they may find their healing and strength in the one over whom death has no dominion. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Father of the risen Lord, we praise you for the sainted dead awaiting peace to obtain the fulfillment of their salvation. Grant that we also may receive that imperishable inheritance kept for us in heaven. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we entrust all for whom we have prayed, confident in your unfailing love and trusting in your holy name.
Amen.
Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive
Yeah.